This is Babette Babich, and this is an overview for the philosophy of technology. Of course, as you see, there's a screen here to give us a sense of what technology is and how philosophy can perhaps help us to understand it. But to do that, as we shall see, we will be questioning. We're going to be looking through this. We meet on Mondays, 10:30 to 12:30, that's Eastern Standard Time. And we're mostly going to try to read through, as a guide throughout the course, Heidegger's The Question Concerning Technology, which is to say that we're going to follow the question Heidegger raises. Just in this translation, you see his name here by William Levitt. I have the book here. There's also a PDF available. All that's very important, but what does it mean to question concerning technology? The formulation is ambiguous, and we will see that, which is why we'll take some time to read it as we proceed. We won't start with it directly. We're going to start with another text, but it's good to let you know in this overview that this is the guide and, as it were, the link that we'll seek to pursue. Heidegger isn't a walk in the park. He's a challenging author, a difficult author. But what makes his questioning approach to technology challenging is that at the same time that he questions concerning technology, Heidegger offers a reflection on taking a position with regard to technology. And he thematizes the very idea of questioning when he raises that question. That is to say, he highlights the way that one finds oneself implicated in and by, and that means already disposed toward technology. Notice the different slides I'm using here before raising such a question. In this, when he raises his question, questioning builds a way when he says this. Well, they want to look at that, and then argues, goes on to say that it is a way of thinking. Heidegger's point is that when we question, when we build that way, it is the fact that we question as we do, that we use the representations that we do, that we use the images that we do, that already set us on a path with respect to what we are asking about. So Heidegger actually reflects on the way that one asks after or about or concerning technology. And to that extent, he suggests that the way that you do that determines the kind of things one assumes about technology, and those assumptions dictate a particular approach, which in turn dictates, or at least outlines, what will or can count as an answer. Nor is Heidegger's own questioning reflection concerning technology any different. Before he begins, Heidegger spells out what might be involved in questioning concerning technology, and he specifies just very, very early in the text, on the first page, in fact, that what's sought just in advance of the enterprise is nothing less than what he calls a free relationship to technology. Now, the word free can seem nugatory, a kind of throwaway, but it may be more elusive than we think. We'll have to think about this throughout the current term. And we'll end the class with a look at a text he writes, you know, just about, depending upon when we count this, 5 or 6 years later, as part of a memorial lecture on Letting Be. The title of the lecture is Gelassenheit, toward which Letting Be, already in the question concerning technology, as we'll see, Heidegger already seems to be going. But what does that mean? One can argue that Heidegger begins his reflections on technology already at the outset of his 1927 Being and Time, and one wouldn't be wrong, or at least not too far wrong, because there Heidegger not only reflects on tools, but also equipment. Equipment tools, equipmentality, Zeug is the German word, that fit together in a technical or technological constellation. Now, in what he calls the formal structure of the question of being, that's in Being and Time, that's the second paragraph, Heidegger reflects on questioning. That is to say, he writes, and this is the Macquarie Robinson translation, every inquiry is seeking, and every seeking gets guided beforehand by what is sought. Very interesting. The reflection on inquiry or questioning looks at the dynamic of the question as such. And as we all already know, already when we ask a question, we know what we're looking for to the extent that we are questioning about it. One undertakes to question in a specific direction. So, and my favorite guy here, as you already see him, is Peter Falk, Colombo. Inquiry is a cognizant seeking for an entity both with regard to the fact that it is and with regard to its being as it is. Now, I like to compare Heidegger's reflection on questioning to the best known questioner on TV of yesteryear. That's Peter Falk's Columbo. As Peter Falk played Columbo, the confusion of the detective, he's younger here, so he, but he's still questioning, you can tell by the gesture, stumbling through his questions, insisting on his questions. By this point in the show, he's probably annoying the suspect. But with that dogged pursuit, disarming the suspects, because they may have been hiding something, but they didn't think that he, of all people, would be able to ferret it out. Now, that's no different from Sherlock Holmes or any Miss Marple story, Agatha Christie, Hercule Poirot. But what's different, and I think this is why Paul Feyerabend was so fond of Columbo, is simply the focus on questioning. For his part, in his Being and Time, Heidegger proceeds, and note that he breaks questioning down to its elements as he does so. As we continue to quote from Being and Time, any inquiry, as an inquiry about something, has that which is asked about, and the German is sein gefragtes. All inquiry, Heidegger continues, about something is somehow a questioning of something. Anfragen by is where you're going to make your inquiry. So in addition to what's asked about, an inquiry, Heidegger says, has that which is interrogated. And then we need our Columbo, right? And Anfragen by requires also a suspect. And befragtes, or something else that we're going to do our research into. And to continue, notice Columbo once again, in his characteristically questioning mode, in what's asked about, there lies that which is to be found out by the asking, das Erfragte. This is what's really intended. So there's what the suspect will think that Columbo's on about, and then there's what he's really on about. Inquiry, Heidegger goes on to say, is also the behavior of a questioner, so we can see that he's behaving as a detective, and therefore of an entity, and consequently has its own character of being. Now, if Heidegger goes on to reflect on what we're doing when we do anything at all, in as much as pretty much anything we do involves what Heidegger calls an equipage, that's a fancy term, the German is Zeug, and just means stuff, the things we have in our kitchen, the things we need to make this Zoom connection, the things we need to read, to write, to watch TV, build something, even if it's just a matter of hanging a picture on a wall. This is Heidegger's example, actually, later on in his book. And in fact, for him, you're already involved in it if you all you're doing is checking to see if it's hanging straight. All of these involve tools in one way or another, involve techniques in one way or another. And Heidegger adds that this includes not only the study for writing as an academic, but the bookseller, the memory of acquisition. How did you come by the book you have? Did you borrow it? Was it a gift from someone significant? Did you buy it at a bookseller, where the question of the bookseller in turn points to an entire constellation. The same thing for the store itself. And in lockdown, that's a particularly painful point or in question as lives crumble because the who owns the shop turns out to be very important. So too, the road on which you might find the shop, illuminated by night, if there were users for the roads, again a question these days, railway stations if the trains run, and for whom, with an awareness of day and night, and inclement weather. Heidegger goes through some, actually all of that, all part of what the German parses as Technik, Zeug, and that is also technology. Now, Wittgenstein, this is fairly interesting, has recourse to a kind of similar reflection on the same array, and he highlights that we need to know what things are for just to be able to see them as such. So if you think, and this is actually, this is a genuine old-fashioned steam locomotive engineer's compartment, this is how the engineer steers the train. I don't even know where the steering wheel is, but anyway, Wittgenstein writes, it's like looking into the cabin of a locomotive. We see handles all looking more or less alike. And you can tell, you can figure out where the engineers really likely got to have access, because that's the seat. So that's for orienting himself to the bits he'll have to be getting hold of. And his assistant, of course, can sit there. But look at this image once again. They look alike, these handles to us, because we don't know what they are. If we were to sign on to become the engineer's apprentice, we'd quickly learn. And as Heidegger, for his own part, goes on, speaking of what he calls equipmentality, we would be able to learn what belonged to the environmental totality, how to handle yourself in this cabin of this locomotive. Heidegger says, for his part, he's kind of not using something so dramatic, but something more mundane, equipment, Zeug. In accordance with its equipmentality, always is in terms of, or out of, its belonging to other equipment, an inkstand, it's old-fashioned Heidegger pen, which you use the inkstand, ink to put in the inkstand, paper, blotting pad, table, lamp, see how he's expanding this, furniture, windows, doors, room. Now, everything about the built environment is a tool, piece of technology, as it were. And it also orients us as such, technically, telling us as such how to move in the world. And that means it's, for its part, also oriented towards the world. Thus, the reference to streets, ways or paths, bridges, buildings, as Heidegger tells us, is through the way that it is set up an uncovering of nature in a particular direction. Very, very important claim. That means that the reference to the train station platform with its shelter overhead against inclement weather. Notice, not everywhere, just where the passengers might be standing. In another locus, I sought to write on the history, as it were, of Heidegger's own reflections in terms of his original lectures to the Club of Bremen at Freiburg. And we see also gives those in Bremen and Freiburg, there are two loci, insight into that which is. And of course, that is Einblick in das, was ist, a very practical, technical reflection, the thing, the danger, the turn, those are the things he's writing about, talking about, lecturing about, along with his reflections on reflection, as well as science in his book that comes later, Was heißt Denken, what's called thinking. It's significant that these lectures are given on the 1st of December, 1949, so 4 years after the end of the war, a series of lectures, a kind of compact seminar for business people, Bremen, Freiburg, written post-war, And that means addressed to the post-war effort. Heidegger repeats the colloquium again in Baden-Baden in March of 1950, so just a little bit later, and again in Munich at the Bavarian Academy of Fine Arts in June, same year, 1950. It's after this, around 1961, that he turns to what's called thinking, his book on the topic, to reflect that science as such, this is going to be one of his most provocative claims, and we're going to be also thinking about the constellation of technoscience in the class. Science, Heidegger says, does not think. So, was heißt denken contains the claim that it's also still about technology and also still about science. But as it turns out, it's also about thinking, and thinking is there a question that is put in question. For Heidegger, the fact that science doesn't think is actually a benefit for science. So that's complicated, and maybe we'll get to that later in the class. I've already suggested that Heidegger's interest in technology predates these lectures, goes back to Being and Time, probably before. But it can be helpful to clarify this is the Wissenschaft denkt nicht, one more time, science does not think. This thing, that's the thing. The second lecture, das Gestell, the setup. And note that I like to render it with the hyphen, and as Heidegger renders it with the hyphen, in English, setup is automatically hyphen sometimes. And it's a little more accurate, I think, as opposed to in framing or positionality, those are standard renderings. Third, and to my mind, the most elusive is die Gefahr. You can imagine why, the danger. And the fourth, entitled in Heideggerian's fight about the notion to this day, the turn, die Kehre. The lectures are featured, and I think I have a copy of it here, but I don't. Yes, I do. I don't see it. Right, Vorträge und Aufsätze. I also have a slide, which is a little easier to see. There we are. Published in 1954, including the text that we've been analyzing, the question concerning technology, die Frage nach der Technik, along with science and reflection, Wissenschaft und Besinnung. That's Heidegger, all very relevant for an understanding of Heidegger's thinking, its more esoteric elements, its evolution, and so on. Okay, but what does it tell us? If we're interested, this is the young Heidegger, this is the older Heidegger, this is his wife, Elfriede, there they are in his Black Forest cabin. But what about if we're not utterly fascinated by Heidegger? What if we want something more? What if we are interested in the question concerning technology for our own part, for us today, for whom technology is not merely a matter of the sort of jet planes and the water turbines Heidegger also mentions in his post-war German landscape, concerned with questions as he's concerned with questions of military transport and incursions and energy resources. Today, technology seems a bit more of a matter of the limitations of our cell phones, our internet access, the vaccine we've developed, mRNA and all that, quantum dots. Actually, this goes back to 2017 in your brain, so it's been around for a bit, and all 5G to be sure, but also surveillance and tracking apps and QR codes and such like. When we used to travel, we cared perhaps only about GPS and getting the guidance from point A to point B in our cars. Today, we still use the technology to track a package on its way to us, or a family member who might be out on a walk, or someone else might do that surveillance. To the same extent, any approach to the philosophy of technology will have to begin by asking our version of Heidegger's question concerning technology. And that's, of course, what Elul does. What do we mean by it? So what counts as technology? Let's go back to this other image. Post a vaccine, remember this frighteningly involves those quantum dots. Are we ourselves GMO items, tech items? Are we not already cyborgs, sleeping perhaps with our phones, maybe with a little ASMR video to conk us out or get us through the night? In this class, we're going to be reading Heidegger along with a number of other authors like Marcuse and Heidegger's student Gunther Anders, but also because of the medical crisis of the times, we'll read Ivan Illich among a range of other names, including various commentators. I've already suggested that we keep in mind that there are a whole sort of complicated abundance, all the books that I wish I had with me, of other approaches to the question concerning technology, not just Heidegger. We're using Heidegger because he thematizes the question as a question. Now, when I began studying philosophy, I took a course from the best, someone could say. He'd certainly say so, Don Eide, author of a number of books on the philosophy of technology at Stony Brook. Now that was way back in the 1970s, back around when Jacques Ellul, I just showed you the image with this little French beret, was writing book after book throughout the 50s and 60s on technology. He wrote La Technique, l'enjeu du siècle in 1958, along with various other texts on society and system and so on. And actually, I once counted them, there's some 30 or 40, there's just a huge amount. For Eide's part, his book Technics and Apraxis, you can see that there, appeared in 78, and Existential Technics came along in 1983. But, and this is part of the reason I began by emphasizing Heidegger, you need phenomenology. In fact, in Eide's case, one needs a Ricoeur-style experimental version of phenomenology. So you can see his experimental phenomenology and introduction that was published in 1977, right? So even before the Technics and Praxis. And you need that to understand him. At the same time, what made up Eide's genius was that there'd be no particular challenge to it if you were to start reading these books. He made it simple. From that first encounter, it was clear to me that certain cliches ruled and would rule, while certain others were seemingly dead on arrival, as it were. In Eide's case, it was all the rage to read Luce Mumford, the historian and author of the book. You can see the Technics reflected in Heidegger's, not Heidegger, Eide's own texts on Technics and Human Development. In this case, Myth of the Machine, volume one, which was part two, also part of that, and three, there would be many of those three-volume series. The human being defined as the human being was, it was always a man the maker, homo faber, with a little time out literally for homo ludens. Thank you, Johann Heutzinger. Although, of course, one could also thank one of Heidegger's own colleagues, author of the play of the world, in the wonderfully titled, that's play as a symbol of the world, Oasis of Happiness. Now, Eugen Fink, the author, gives us an ontology of play. Game theorists are still thinking this through. And to this, one should, of course, add reflections on the internet. And I have a book on that myself, and I will be sharing some PDFs along with the interface effect. Also, the gold farmers, we're doing that kind of right now, as Alexander Galloway writes in 2012. That's his book. We'll have to see what Galloway says about the most recent version of Gamergate, but now has a different name. This time it's for profit rather than sex affairs and harassment. Eide also followed the then very popular and still for Americans today popular, I'd say, focus on praxis. That means that he took himself to the horse's mouth to listen to the then popular existential philosophy, the existential pleasures of engineering, of the engineer Samuel Flourman, born in 1925, just a year after Simondon. Today, Flourman's forgotten, and Simondon's stock continues to rise by contrast with a beleaguered resistance to authors like Ellul or Ivan Illich, quite by contrast with still dominant enthusiasms for Marshall McLuhan, and we're going to begin, when we get, after we come back after the 22nd, by reading Neil Postman's Technopoly. Although it can seem to repeat without necessarily mentioning that it repeats John Street's Politics and Technology or Gil Germain's Discourse on disenchantment. Now, one can write a book on technology, even a successful book. I mentioned or could mention influential for Don Eide, Albert Borkman, who was for a tiny, tiny moment influential. And one can still disappear, as Borkman's work did, in short order. Others include Paul Durbin and so on. Now, if you're Langdon winner, it may move you, it doesn't always work, to write two books, to write the same book, as it were, twice. Once esoterically autonomous technology, the other more pitched to the times, the whale and the reactor. Today, these days, we're big into things post-Bruno Latour and the already mentioned Simondon. You can maybe say this with a French accent, but you can also bring in Dutch authors like Peter Paul Verbeek, What Things Do. For my part, I prefer Clifford Stoll, Silicon Snake Oil, which he wrote in 1996, and then, a little surprisingly, some years later, High Tech Heretic. I wonder what he would say about Zoom, why computers don't belong in the classroom. There are others, a lot of them. At the end, we'll talk about Paul Virilio, speed and such. But there's also, very crucially, we already mentioned him, Ivan Illich. Let me conclude this brief orientation. I'm going to post a short video to continue it, just to take us over the break. We don't meet on the 15th. Thanks for your attention.